Right, straight up thing about Bleach, this chapter is that the one thing that was very good and something that I liked, yet the other thing, it was kind of just like, it wasn't that great. Okay, overall as a chapter, it wasn't that great. It was executed very poorly and it was really disappointing to see, to be honest with you. There were certain things I expected off Kyoku, which I still think can happen later on down the road, but as for the time being, I think that what Kubo was trying to go was to give Nanao some development, but I didn't really think it hit the mark, to be honest with you, and it is a shame that things turned out this way. And as much as I would have loved for this fight as a whole to have worked, the whole thing with Lele, yeah, he was a very powerful character. We see feats, we know, you know, he's got a monstrous amount of strength and power that he's definitely very war material and would give anyone a hard time. The issue is that I think for him personally is not the character development. Lele didn't have character development. He had transformations that made him powerful, and in the end it didn't work out for him. The battle wasn't about him, which is a shame because I would have loved to have somewhat cared. Don't get me wrong, as much as like an awesome character of like him being OP and just like whoa, like he definitely gives off that factor. The one thing I don't care about is his actual character development. Why should I care about this character? What has he done but be a kind of wall in the way of the main fight, so to say? I mean, with the Mayuri and Pinarda fight, at least we're learning a bit more about Pinarda and a bit more about the Quinces and whatnot. But with this, I just kind of felt like, you know, really? Just like, why should I care, Kubo? Give me a reason why I should care about him as a character, and I just didn't get that. Unfortunately, this chapter was thrown in with a bit of past, which, to be fair, as I said, Kubo really knows how to throw in a past kind of timeline, and it always works. We understand why Kyoko has two hairpins. One was given to his brother by his wife, and one was Nanao's mother, obviously. So that's why he had two, and that's where they came from. But also, as well as the hairpins, I kind of want to go into Kyoko's brother a second, even though it is 99% probably not going to be brought up, and it's all speculation at this point. But I'd like to throw in a little extra bit of detail. What Kyoko was saying about his brother, saying that he'd mellowed out due to old age, and he was saying it was because of Nanao's mother that he had mellowed out and become a calm and much, you know, reasonable person, really goes to question what was Kyoku's brother like beforehand. Was he in the Gotei 13, the original, the bloodthirsty Gotei 13? And is it possible that If You Watch does bring him back? If you didn't see that theory that I did, go check it out. If You Watch does bring back that original Gotei 13, will Kyoku's brother be within that mix, and will Kyoku, you know, go more in depth within his Bankai? And this is what I'm going to get to later, so just bear with me. Or was it the fact that maybe Kyoku and Kyoko's brother, their father or mother, was in the Gotei 13 and was brought up a very kind of bloodthirsty lifestyle? I'm not quite sure, as again, this is all theoretical and probably not going to be brought up upon, but if my theory of You Watch bringing back the old Gotei 13 or anything about the old Gotei 13 comes into check, if he was one of them or their father was one of the bloodthirsty Gotei 13, it is going to be interesting, and that's where I think is going to hit Kyoko right on the mark. Because as much as I say, you know, this was disappointing and it was about Nanao and Kyoko and we got the Bankai, and don't get me wrong, everybody loved that Bankai. This was the main thing of this battle, which everyone loves. I can't take that away. And the fact that he only used half of what his Bankai was, you know, he was limited to only one, I guess, one of his juices, if that makes sense, it definitely made an impact. One sword compared to the two that he has made a massive, deadly impact, which was very creative. It was unique, and it definitely gave him the reason to why he couldn't use it all these years within the fights that he had. And it was fantastic. Everybody loved it. It was great. So if later on down the road something like this does soon to spur on and Kyoku is left to face a family member later on down the road, then I think it's going to be very pinnacle to the point where he does kind of finish off his Bankai, where he kind of does use that other ability. And I think we're going to get more flesh out Kyoku. It is without a doubt. Who's he going to be with? I don't know. And that's the theory I'm going to throw out there. So of course, tell me your thoughts on that. But the thing is, when it comes to now and why I say it failed, is it was kind of, I guess, very lackluster. It wasn't executed. I wasn't hype. I wasn't excited. You had this god weapon, which of course was a convenience that many people had pointed out. And they were very, I guess, very on the fence with it, more in the negative area than in the good. And I always gave it that kind of, you know, I'll wait and see where Kubo goes with this. He started started off well with Nanao not knowing how to kind of fight with a sword, and it dragged on a little bit, and I kind of felt like Kubo knew where he was going to go with this. Unfortunately, I just don't see where this is going to go now. I don't see where Nanao is going to go with this. I don't see where this weapon's going to come within relevancy, and if Nanao is the only one that can use this weapon, I'm very disappointed. She has no fighting experience. People want to complain about lieutenants, but then again, you know, what have we seen of Iba? Really, what have we seen of Komamura's Lieutenant Iba? We haven't seen shit. Nemu couldn't really do anything until this R. I mean, at the end of the day, I think Lieutenant, like, kind of class is irrelevant, because we know Ikkaku is a 3rd C and Yumachika is a 5th C, and they're, like, above Lieutenant level, if not Lieutenant level anyway. I think ranks are pretty much irrelevant, because if the commander or the squad captains want someone as a Lieutenant, they will make that happen. Unfortunately, it's only some of the cases where generally there is some Lieutenants that deserve being Lieutenants, such as Izuru, such as Hisagi, such as maybe Rongiku, such as Momo to a certain extent. At least they know how to fight, and they know their Zanpakuto, and they know how to use it. At least they've experienced war, and they've experienced, you know, going to the Soul Reaper Academy, learning Kidos, etc. like that. Nanao did exactly the same, but she couldn't fight with a sword. And I think she should have gone to the Kido Cup. She should have stayed knowing to what she knew best. I would have loved it if Kubo kind of went the direction of, yeah, we've got this holy sword, it's fucking OP as fuck, but she doesn't know how to fight. How do we overcome that situation? We overcome it with Nanao kind of developing as a character, as a fighter, not only by kind of learning how to fight with a sword or learning how to use the actual weapon, because Kyoroku shouldn't know how to use it, but I think rather you throw in a mixture of Kidos, have this Aikido battle. I want to see more Kido battles. Kubo, throw in Kido in there. Let Nanao use what she knows. Let her kind of make a kind of decent fight, a struggle, and then while she's kind of figuring out, like, using barriers, using binding Kidos, using all sorts of different restrictiveness, barriers, anything, really, there's loads of Kidos that would have come in useful, and while she's buying time, and I think this would have been a very good move on Kubo's part, while she's buying time, she's learning how this all works, she's looking at it, she's kind of seeing that there's no kind of, I guess, sharp edge, she's kind of like finding out on her own way how this works, and I feel that would have worked. So that's why I kind of say it is very lackluster and it wasn't executed properly, and it's a shame, but I am glad that X-Axis or Lele fucking Barrow, whatever you want to fucking call him, I'm glad this is over. I'm glad that his attack hits himself. A god's power can only kill a god, I guess, and he kind of cracked and disintegrated, so he is technically dead, or I would love to fucking hope so. So I'm hoping we get onto Gerald Valkyrie or the Miracle next week and kind of get on with that. But I do think the way I said how this fight could have worked out with the convenience of having this weapon, I generally think that would have been a lot better, and Kubo should just listen to me. So with that being said, I'm gonna leave it at that. So tell me your thoughts on my version and this version. Which do you prefer? Do you like the fear with Kyoroku about, you know, he still has a lot of potential to go on, especially with the later fights with Yuwabark and what potentially he could be doing and the prediction that I've got. But with that being said, here's the comments from last week. What did you think of this chapter? What do you think you could have done better? And what did you think of the fight as a whole, including the Bankais, including, you know, X-Axis shooting Hisagi and all that kind of stuff? And what did you think of X-Axis as a character? Do you think we should have got more development within him? So with that being said, I'm going to leave you with something else real quick. There is a link in the description of my friend Claudio Taku's petition on the Bleach anime. I do want to support it, even though I don't agree with it for now, and I have my reasons. If you guys want to go support Bleach, if you want to show that there is an audience for it, I've already signed for it, and if you guys want to do so, there is a link in the bottom. Just sign the petition and we'll see where we can go with this, hopefully somewhere, and hopefully you can prove me wrong. So with that being said, I'm gonna catch you motherfuckers out. You guys have this fun, Debbie and Hansen. Peace out.